and entrepreneurial genius. He is chairman and CEO and founder of Amazon.com. It is the world's largest retailer on the internet. I am pleased to have him here. How would you then characterize what the business of Amazon.com is today?
Well, we are, first of all, we want to be Earth's most customer-centric company. So we think of ourselves as a customer company. We want our brand to be known for this abstract notion of starting with the customer and working backwards. I think those abstract brands provide more flexibility and robustness than than brands that are associated with concrete things like product categories.
We want to be the Amazon.com of the web.
Of the world. Of the web.
Yeah. What that means is that we want to personalize the. So there are all these things that you can only do online, yeah. Like personalize. We have 20 million customers today. We want to have 20 million different stores, each store customized for that individual customer. And that's something you can't even begin
How many
to
stores?
Think. 20 million stores. If we have 20 million customers,
you want 20 million stores.
The Charlie Rose store should not be the same as the Jeff Bezos store because we undoubtedly have some different interests.
And different products to sell.
And different, you'll be interested in different things than I will.
Yeah. How do you stay in touch with that kind of experimentation and that kind of energy?
Hire smart people.
And how do you go about that?
If you don't hire, because you know, a single individual cannot keep in touch with the plethora of, you know, of new things happening. So what you have to do is you have to put in place a recruiting process that attracts and retains smart, talented, hardworking people who want to be a part of your mission, whatever it is.
Then when you talk to them, when they bring out the CEO to talk to these people, what's the mission statement you tell them?
First, it's Earth's most customer-centric company, and we have a very, and I explain what we mean by that, because we have a very precise definition for customer-centric. It means listen, invent, and personalize. So first, you have to listen to customers. Companies that don't listen to customers fail. Second, you have to invent for customers, because companies that only listen to customers fail. It's not the customer's job to invent for themselves. It's our job at Amazon.com to invent things like OneClick and other things, like sales rank going from 1 to 18 million. Those kinds of things that customers really like, that's our job, not theirs, to think of that. And third is personalize. Take every individual customer and put them at the center of their own universe. And then, when we talk about Earth's most customer-centric company, we mean that in a very broad way. This is bigger than Amazon.com. What we want to do is sort of uplift the worldwide standards for customer service and customer centricity. So this is sort of like Sony. Sony, sort of born right after World War II, is a company that set out, if you go and look at their early mission statement, it was not to be known for quality. It was to make Japan known for quality. Not Sony, Japan. And that's sort of what we want to do. We want to do something bigger than Amazon.com.
To make what? Would define it for me.
It would be that that we set a new example for customer service and customer centricity that other companies look at, admire, and want to emulate. And that is a mission that people can get excited about.
I've talked to a lot of people who have created great companies. Most of them believe, in, at least in conversation with me, that if they had to start over, they could do it again. My question to you, if you had to start over, what would you do?
Well, so first of all, I believe that as hard as we have worked at Amazon.com, and I'm talking about all 7,000 of us, we have also been incredibly lucky. So I believe that
because of timing, or because
timing
of
is the main thing. There are lots of things that we even decisions we made that were the wrong decision that somehow miraculously worked out anyway.
Yeah.
So there are, I believe that all startup companies require huge amounts of luck. So certainly if you don't work hard and if you don't have a good plan, no amount of luck will save you.
Yeah.
But there are lots of companies that work hard, lots of companies with smart folks, and lots of them don't succeed.
When did this dream start for you?
So when I don't really remember the exact day or anything, but when I was in college is when I started thinking about wanting to be an entrepreneur someday. So it was, I was not the kid with the lemonade stand. You know, I wasn't one of these kids who was always trying to raise money. I always wanted to be a scientist when I was little. But I'd also always loved computers. I was lucky because at my age this is unusual to have access to a mainframe computer from my elementary school when I was in fourth grade. and quickly learned that there was a pre-programmed Star Trek game on that computer, and then I never did anything except play Star Trek with the computer. So I don't know how formative that was. It certainly helped my Star Trek knowledge considerably. But I've always loved computers. Somewhere in college, I started watching some of the people who were like setting up, you know, college pizza delivery services, and you know, the kind of the core entrepreneurs, and thinking, you know, this looks like a really fun thing to do.
They then come back to you and say, when will this be a profitable company? When will I see in your annual report bottom line profitability?
So we will tell them, thanks for asking, but we're not going to share that information.
Because what we're doing is more important to us in the long-range health of this company.
No, that's not. So just to be clear, no one cares more about profitability than Amazon.com. And we're actually putting more focus on it today internally than we did a year ago.
Why?
The reason is that the scale of our business is such. So now, you know, we have annualized revenues of about $2.5 billion a year. Let me give you... That means that if you can make a 1% improvement in efficiency, right. And believe me, we have these little 1% improvements laying all over the place to be picked up. It's an opportunity. And if you make a 1% improvement, that's $25 million to the bottom line. If you had a company with, you know, a few thousand dollars in annual revenue, or $1 million, or $10 million, to spend any time at all on trying to get that 1% improvement in efficiency would be crazy. You should be spending that time trying to get more revenue so that you have more operating leverage, so that then when you do the operating efficiency improvements. So the simple answer to your question is, so that you get more leverage. The simple answer is, we just have such a big company now in terms of revenues that it would be irresponsible not to focus on efficiency.
What do you say to them? If they say, give us some free advice, Jeff, you're coming down the road and we know how fast you're going. So
the physical stores?
Yeah.
Well, the first thing I would say is we're talking about 15%, not 100%.
Yeah.
So I think even over 10 plus years. The second thing I would say is figure out what your strengths are and emphasize those. One of the things I do think you see is companies that are great in the physical world spending too much time, energy, and attention online. And I think, you know, they should have a certain amount of skepticism when I say this, because of course I'd like them not to do that.
Yeah.
But I really do believe it's the truth, right? I really do believe that they could, that, you know, that if you have, let's say you have two big competitors in the physical world, and one of them decides to go whole hog for the internet, and the other one says, you know what we're gonna do is we're gonna just try to get a bigger piece of that 85% and really focus on our physical world business while our competitor is distracted, I actually think that would be a very good strategy, and it's what I might do if I were in their position.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
So you'd say to Barnes & Noble and Borders, forget this online stuff and just take care of your own business.
Well, I would certainly say that. But I actually do believe that the skill sets are so different. You know, I've always said...
Oh, but that's
said,
a different reason they can't acquire the skills.
They can acquire them, but slowly. And meanwhile, if they had, right now they're not getting hurt very much, because I think all of the you know, if you take a segment like books, you know, I think Borders and Barnes & Noble are equally distracted with online.
Yeah.
But I'd say if one of them had decided to just focus on their physical world business while the other one was distracted with online, that could have been a tactical advantage.
So you're saying Barnes & Noble, for example, probably... by so focusing and looking what to do to your challenge and getting online, probably lost some...
I do think that's true.
Something.
And I think that, and I've always said too, that it would, in my opinion, would have been easier for Barnes & Noble, and by the way, I picked them because they're a great physical world retailer.
Yeah. And they know a lot about how to sell books.
They do a fantastic job, probably one of the best physical world retailers. You compare them to the electronics guys, who I love to compete with, because I think they're terrible.
Yeah, exactly.
But Barnes & Noble's always done a great job, but I think it would have been easier for them to open a new chain of hardware stores than it was to sell books.
They could
books
have found a better place to spend their energy and time and money.
Because the two businesses are actually so similar. You know, selling hardware in the physical world is very similar in many ways. They could have done that, but this is hard.
It won't be going
for new financing in 2001.
We don't need to. We've always said that we reserve the right to, in the case of, you know, that we may want to increase the strength of the balance sheet or for strategic reasons. What, you know, we always reserve our flexibility, but we've said we don't need to.
So we're not going to be running out of money anytime soon.
No.
The other question that comes up is in terms of this profitability thing that everybody, inevitably, if you talk to you, you have to ask. It is, you have already pinpointed the last quarter of the year 2001, mm-hmm. right? And that is counting the interest that you have to pay on the money you borrowed.
Not counting the interest. So this is a first step for us. What we are, what we've set as a goal is a pro forma operating profit this Q4. And so the operating versus net, so a net profit would include the interest expense.
Right.
An operating profit does not.
So you have an operating profit at the end of this year.
That's what we're going
for. It's a goal, or are you pretty sure about this?
Well, we resisted for 5 years answering that question. So we have a high degree of confidence, but at the same time, whenever I say that, I always tell people that there are no guarantees. Mm. There's a lot of work to be done between now and then, but we're on track. What startup companies do is they take their precious early capital dollars and systematically eliminate risks. That's what they do, the successful ones.
Hmm.
Now, what we worry about now is that we don't do our job. And I'll tell you, one of the things in this period that I kind of like is that it's a lot easier in the year 2001 for Amazon.com as a company to be humble, working our butts off, than it was in 1999 when the world believed we couldn't lose. We're a company, you know, it's kind of handy to be an underdog.
It's also very important when planning a business like this, I think, to sort of look at what is the brand promise that you're going to make to customers. And the brand promise that you make has to actually coincide and very, very closely with the things that you can deliver. kind of an important but sometimes overlooked component, I think. And in our case, that led to the name of Amazon.com. It's it's basically Earth's biggest river, Earth's biggest bookstore. And we wanted to use this large selection to be able to build an authoritative store. Authoritative means a few things: authoritative selection, authoritative prices, and authoritative information about books so that you can make a purchase decision. And the internet allowed us to do all of those things. We could have more selection. We could also have lower prices because we don't have to have retail real estate in high traffic areas that's very expensive. Inventorying books in those spaces is very expensive. We get to inventory our books in very low cost warehouse space. It's also possible to have more information online about products than you could ever have in a physical shopping environment. So you can really build an authoritative store. So we opened the store in July of 1995, almost 3 years ago now, after doing about a year of software development. And the store has grown very rapidly. At this point, our sales are about the equivalent of 50 of those big chain superstores. And the interesting thing is that we opened the equivalent of 12 of those superstores in just the last 3 months. So things are growing fast. We ship books regularly to over 160 different countries. In our first 30 days of being open, we ship books to more than 45 countries in all 50 states. There are some interesting stories about the international. So for example, we ship 4 orders a day at least to Bulgaria every day. I believe that the primary success factor for Amazon.com has been an obsession over the customer and a focus on customer service. This is clearly important in any business, but especially important online. And the reason for this is that word of mouth is incredibly powerful online. If you make a customer unhappy on the internet, they won't tell 5 friends. They will tell 5,000 friends. Likewise, of course, if you can make a customer happy by meeting or exceeding their expectations, they can also tell 5,000 people and therefore, you know, be evangelists for you. They can use the internet as a megaphone. So it's very important to do the things that you actually are going to claim to do. And what this means basically is the balance of power has shifted away from the merchant and toward the consumer.
which is a great thing, I think, for everybody involved. And it's even great for the merchant, as long as the merchant realizes it. One of the statistics that we track most carefully at Amazon.com, because we believe that this is so important, is the fraction of orders we receive every day that are from repeat customers. And that number has consistently gone up, and it's now over 58% of our orders that we receive every day, even in the context of a very rapid new customer growth. One of the great things, too, online is that the customers help you figure out what you're doing wrong and how to do things better. Email is this great medium for receiving feedback, because somehow email turns off that little piece of everyone's brain that causes them to mostly be polite. So what happens is, you know, if you go into a restaurant and have a bad meal, very rarely you're trying to have a good time. I never go into the kitchen, grab the chef by the scruff of the neck and say, you know, you really shouldn't be cooking. But online with email, that will happen in a heartbeat. And and we've benefited greatly from that, and have, I believe, in the 3 years that we've actually been doing business, I suspect we've received more feedback, both positive and negative, people helping us improve our service, than probably most business establishments have received in the last 20 years. But we do work very hard, and we'll never make Amazon.com fun and engaging in the same ways that great physical bookstores are. You'll never be able to hear the bindings creak and smell the books and have tasty lattes and soft sofas at Amazon.com. But we can do completely different things that will blow people away and make the experience an engaging and fun one. And I'll talk about some of the stuff that we can do in the future a little later. There are dozens of off-the-shelf systems you can buy to handle inbound phone calls into a call center and so on. We get thousands of email messages from our customers every day, and there aren't any great off-the-shelf inbound email center software packages yet. There will be. So we've had to write our own. In fact, about 85% of all of our software development to date has actually gone into the back-end systems that are completely invisible to customers, the logistics systems that handle 2.5 million different items in 6 different availability categories. Early on, we looked at, could we buy a software package that would do the logistics for us? The problem is that if you look at the available packages that are built for mail order companies, they typically have just 2 availability categories, in stock and back ordered. We actually have 6 because we have books that are shipped within 24 hours, 2 to 3 days, 1 to 2 weeks, 4 to 6 weeks, not yet published, shipped when available, and one more out of print, shipped within 1 to 3 months if we can find it at all. So some of this stuff just has to be done the hard way.